it's a daily decision if you want to be in love that day. And we have this language that talks about it happening to us, like it's an outside force and we fall into love, as opposed to making a conscious decision to say, I want to love you, I'm going to love you, and I'm choosing to love you.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Ron and Jan, welcome to Focus on the Family.
Thank you so much for having us. We're glad to be here.
Okay, well, let's get into it. You've been married over 30 years now. I understand you decided to get engaged only 4 days after meeting each other.
Wow.
Okay, everybody's going, what? Honey, did you hear that? 4 days? What's that all about?
I think this is my wife's story to tell.
Oh, nice punt. I'm going to punt this one right over to my wife.
Ron and I were at DU together, and I was...
Denver University.
Yes, Denver University, and I had him in several classes, and I thought, wow, he's so smart. I would read an article and be like, where did he get that from? And so I kind of observed him and liked the way he interacted with people, and we ended up doing a project together, and we were able to... he asked me out, and he was... when we left, he wanted to borrow a quarter because he was going to move someone from our date to another date.
He was going
to
make a phone call.
Make a phone call.
And I don't look very good in this part of the story, just so you know.
And thank goodness the line was busy because I asked him what it was, and he says, well, explain that. And I was like, I like movies, and we were never apart. So we talked
really
all
fast,
night.
Condensed story there.
I had to move one date around to make room for another, so it didn't turn out to work very well. But the end result is we spent a lot of time together over the next few days, and after 3 or 4 days of spending time together, we looked at each other and said, should we go look at rings? And we're like, yeah, let's do that.
Okay, so then you get married.
Yep.
How did that go in the early days of your marriage?
We had to get to know each other after we got married.
Right. I would think there were some problems.
Not the best plan. As you hear our story unfold a bit, you'll find that one of the reasons that I wanted this to happen so quickly was that I was a really insecure guy. I needed to control things and be in charge. I was really concerned that if she really got to know me, then what would happen is she probably wouldn't want to marry me.
Yeah.
And so I wanted it to happen quickly and soon so that God could move things along, because I was pretty insecure about how that would work otherwise.
So did that come out pretty quickly then? What I would describe as a marriage trap in some ways. I'm not trying to be unkind, obviously, Ron.
No,
but
on our...
when you try to compensate for those insecurities, it's kind of like, get the girl and then we'll deal with my issues later.
Right, and to the point of the controlling, I couldn't leave the apartment without him. And if I chose to do something, I would kind of pay for it because it would be an inquisition. He would keep asking questions. What did you do?
Tough.
Who did you see?
Yeah.
And it got to the point, it's not worth that.
Yeah. And in fact, in your book, you talk about the difference between falling in love and jumping in love. What's your distinction?
You know, that's where these choices come in, right, Jim? It's a matter of, it's a daily decision if you want to be in love that day. And we have this language that talks about it happening to us, like it's an outside force and we fall into love, as opposed to making a conscious decision to say, I want to love you, I'm going to love you, and I'm choosing to love you.
Yeah.
And in my case, after a year, she told me, this is not working. And in God's perfect world, I would have been healed, everything would have been great. In reality, it was probably 8 or 10 years.
And
there's nothing I regret more in my life than the fact that she had to help me become the man God wanted me to be.
Well, and the irony is, that is in part what marriage is about. Unfortunately, in the modern world, we've lost that understanding. And we'll unfold some of that as we move through the story. You also mentioned something called choice theory. You say that it can bring hope to any marriage. So walk us through choice theory.
You know, I think there's a level of expectation people have, and there's a level of understanding that makes them think this is just the way it is, and it's the way it has to be, and there's not much more we can do about it. Choice theory says that in every single situation, you have opportunities. God created us to be a certain kind of person in His image, and we can act in that image if we so choose, or we can act not to. And so what I've done in my understanding of choice theory is to apply that to how couples make choices. Whether it's getting up in the morning and deciding, today I'm going to honor my wife, I'm going to look at her in the face and tell her how beautiful she is, and I'm going to try to be a person that will honor and respect and love my partner, or I'm going to be someone who will honor and respect and love my wife or my husband in a way that is more about me than about them.
Yeah.
And I think that's where it comes from.
Yeah. And in one of those, you mentioned it's a choice to be unselfish. And I think when you look at marriages and you, you know, embrace a Christian perspective, you're trying to walk more like Christ. Mm-hmm. This is exactly, I think, why he created marriage the way he did. Mm-hmm. Because we're attracted to opposites. Yeah. That typically can rub you the wrong way over time. And what you've got to learn to do is to choose to be unselfish, because we're selfish creatures because of our sin nature, right? Exactly.
I think there's two kinds of models of marriage in the world right now. One is the me kind of marriage, and one's the us marriage. The me marriage really focuses on this idea that I'm in this for me. As soon as you don't meet my needs, I'm out. And you see divorces, you see people who have affairs, because it's about me, and if I don't get my needs met, I'm going to go find someone who does.
Let me ask you this question about the early years of your marriage, mm-hmm. the first 8 to 10 years then. Jan, you had to be unselfish to recognize Ron's controlling, temperament. How did you survive that?
Well, my father was very similar in a way of the control. And so it was very easy for me because I wanted him to be happy, and I would sacrifice everything that so he could be happy and that things would be good. And I really wish I'd had someone tell me that you have to hold them accountable.
Well, right. Easy isn't necessarily healthy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And that's a big point. So that's what you're saying, is that I went with it, and mm-hmm. you allowed it to happen.
And that's what happens, I think, in a lot of those things, because for your insecurities or whatever reason, you hold back some of the things you might have said to the person.
Right.
And you just kind of keep doing that. And so it's not always beneficial in your marriage. So mm-hmm. when controlling, you also have a part in allowing that, makes sense.
Yeah, and I appreciate that honesty, really, both of you, to talk about those first 8 to 10 years. I think for a couple that may be in that situation right now, they're still at year four. Yeah. Let's just imagine mm-hmm. that couple who's listening. How can we cut their pain in half? They don't have to go 8 to 10 years. What were some of those things in those years 6, 7, and 8 that begin to change things for you? What was it that woke you both up to this unhealthiness?
So I remember the day God slapped me across the face with this. Mm-hmm. My sons were starting to talk to my wife in that same manner. Why aren't you where you're supposed to be? Why didn't you get me here? You need to do this for me. And I gave him the dad lecture, right? Don't talk to your mom that way. And I remember God just slapping me across the head and saying, who do you think is teaching them to disrespect women? Mm-hmm. I've taught you a different way to value your wife. Mm. Why are you doing this? And there was this inconsistency between my faith and between what I was. And I think that's that couple you're talking about in year four. I think there's an inconsistency between, I love you, I'm going to church with you, I'm telling you, I value you, but when we get home, I'm telling you what you need to do for me. Let me give you a quick example. I would ask Jan something like, where do you want to go for dinner? I really wasn't asking her, where would you like to go for dinner? I wanted to start a conversation about barbecue, right?
I mean, so you actually knew.
Yeah.
See, I'm the guy that really doesn't know where I want to go for dinner. I could care less.
Yeah. And I wish I could portray myself in a better light, but I can't, because it wasn't just Jan I did that with. That was how I worked my life.
Because what's the root of that?
Insecurity. It's like I'm so scared about things getting out of control that as long as I can control everything, it'll be okay. And I fight that every day, trying to say, if I trust God and God has my back, why am I so anxious and worried?
Where did that come from?
My mom, God bless her, she was an anxious woman, but she was kind of like the glass wasn't just half empty, it was draining rapidly, if that makes sense.
Oh, it does.
She could look around the corner and see all the things that could go wrong.
So fear and anxiety.
Yeah, and I got really good at trying to do enough to maybe prevent those bad things.
Yeah, I mean, there usually is that, you know, early childhood development issue that people encounter.
And it worked well until I got married, and then it caused a lot of problems.
Yeah.
Our guests today on Focus on the Family with Jim Daly are Dr. Ron Welch and his wife, Jan. And Ron has written a book, 10 Choices Successful Couples Make, The Secret to Love That Lasts a Lifetime. He unpacks this choice theory and has a lot of great insights in the book. We would commend it to you. We've got it at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast or call 800, the letter A and the word families.
Yeah, I think many people are going to lean into this next question because it affects all of us as human beings. It's just part of being in this earth. You mentioned a choice that you outline is choosing to let go of old baggage. And Jan, I think this was especially difficult for you, even though we've heard Ron's letting go of some of that baggage. How has your past affected your marriage?
I think it impacted it a lot. As I said, being controlled was kind of normal for me. I didn't know something different. And pleasing somebody.
So
and
you
that
were
was my...
pretty much always controlled by your own parents, right?
Yeah, my dad, okay. Pretty much.
And that, do you think that helped you make a decision to marry Ron? Because you saw that in him?
Yeah.
And it was comfortable?
I don't think I saw that in him.
Okay.
I didn't really realize it until after we were married. And then it was like, oh, I married my dad. But not but in a good way for many. Because people that think about a controlling person, there's so many wonderful qualities about him. He's an amazing person. That was just a part that we needed to work on. And I really didn't do my part in holding him accountable, saying, no, I'm going to go and be with my friends. And
well, Jan, in fact, in the book, I think you position it as blaming yourself. Which, can I say this so that women can hopefully release this? Women are so quick to look at their own selves.
Yes.
And sometimes that's good, but sometimes it can become unhealthy, and that's what you're describing.
It was very unhealthy.
If you're always blaming yourself, that's not the right spot.
No, that's not good. And baggage is what kind of weighs you down, and when you unpack it, it stays in the marriage, and you use it as a crutch. And so getting rid of that baggage and really looking at it, it helps so much, letting go.
You know, as Ron's describing that, the day that God slapped you in the face, that's how you described it. Mm-hmm. What was that reckoning for you? I would think your self-awareness would have been a little more difficult because it's so much more appreciated, if I could say it that way. The fact that you're sacrificing, you're laying yourself down. Sometimes we see that as tremendous Christian attributes.
Mm-hmm. I had a hard time believing that it was really going to happen. So
The
change. That I'm going to choose to do these. I'm not going to control. I'm not going to do these things. I wish I could say that I was like, great, thanks. It's going to be perfect.
When did you find the courage to say, hey, Ron, can I challenge that a little bit? Did you ever
have anniversary?
The first anniversary.
Yeah, I said I feel like I'm in a golden cage because there's other good things, but I can't get out of the cage because you won't let me.
So that was the beginning of an 8-more-year journey.
Mm-hmm. I think a few more years.
Yeah,
because my part in not really trusting in it, because at some point it always came back up again, and they're like, and so you have to work through that.
Right. And I, you
trust.
Know, again, I appreciate that. Couples are going to be living right in this space. Yeah. And so your vulnerability and your great book, 10 Choices Successful Couples Make, is a great tool for couples that are having a hard time, specifically in this area of control and self-doubt, it sounds like.
I sure wish that she had been able to believe me, but it was 4 or 5 more years before she thought old Ron was not going to rear his head. And she still questions. I mean, I know for a fact, I'll do really well trying to be the guy I want to be that God created me to be. And then I'll get that look from her, and I know she's seen something. I'm like, uh-oh, what did I do?
Mm-hmm.
Because I still worry about that, having her feel that way.
Well, speak for a moment to those deep patterns that we learn as children and then how we, you know, manifest those as adults. This is, you know, almost compulsive behavior. It's hard to grab a hold of that. And when you have that thought, to take that captive so it doesn't come out of our mouth, as James talks about the power of the tongue. Yep. So what discipline have you applied, self-discipline, to change those things?
I had a student, I'm a professor up at Denver Seminary, I had a student ask me that exact question maybe a year or so ago. Because
what
they
a
wanted
bright
to know,
student.
Very good student, very good student. And part of the answer was, you can't start by trying to change your entire life. You can't just say, I'm going to be different tomorrow.
Wow, that's good.
You have to start with a small choice and say, so what could I do today that would lead me to make a selfless choice or an unselfish choice as opposed to a selfish choice? So it might be something like, okay, you said you wanted to play softball. I'm talking to the guys out there. They assume they have a softball game, so they should just go play softball. But they don't ask their wife whether the wife would take care of the kids that night. They just assume, oh, it'll be fine. She wants to go out with the girls, and there's like some permission needed. That's a power issue. That's not okay. Everybody
where one
say,
needs permission, the other doesn't.
Yeah, it should be a matter of saying, so how can I serve you today? What would you like to do tonight so you could really get closer to God? If you want to go to Bible study, I'll take care of the kids. But more of the time, you look at people's schedules. I have the couples I work with. I'm a marriage therapist. I have the couples pull out their planners, and you'll see everybody in there. You'll see their job, their dog, some guy named Frank. I mean, everybody shows up in their schedules, but their own names don't show up in each other's schedule because they don't plan time. They don't think about the week and say, when are we going to be married this week? So one of the choices I try to make with Jan is to say, today, when are we going to be married today?
That is so good.
And it's great, you know, especially when you know that person is thinking about you and really cares about what you may want to do, which was such a change in our marriage, because it was always, what did he want to do? If he wanted barbecue and I wanted Mexican, we would go get barbecue. And now
in the
old days. And now he's like, where do you really want to go? And I'm like, I feel like I can say that. I mean, I know it's a silly, simple thing, but it really impacts your life in other ways.
Well, I'm with you. Let's go get Mexican
food. Amen. Sounds good to me.
You know, Ron, I wanted to ask you this too. You have a statement or a descriptor called the Niagara Falls analogy that helps couples de-escalate. Mm-hmm. So often, I mean, even for Gene and I, that's what we need so often is, how do I de-escalate this? Because I've said something that obviously has triggered her. And sometimes I look for that de-escalation and sometimes I don't. So speak to that. How do I Niagara Fall this in a healthier way? How do I pull back? Especially if you want to win in this moment, which is a competitive nature thing, which I do possess. And so, you know, it's about, hey, how do I win this argument? Uh-huh. Okay, help me out, Mr. Therapist.
You betcha. I'm so glad you asked about that, Jim. This is the single most effective thing I've ever seen in counseling.
Well, this is important.
It is so amazing. I was in the prison system for many years.
Which side?
Yeah. Not in prison.
As a psychologist, I was not an inmate. I guess I should explain that for the listeners. Yes.
I got it.
But
prison
I worked with a lot of inmates with a lot of anger problems. Yeah. And I met a guy named Bill Fleeman who was doing work on Niagara Falls, looking at how that affected anger. And I said, man, can I use this for marriage? And afterwards, his organization let me use this with marriage couples. And what I do is, have you ever been to Niagara Falls?
I have.
Big waterfall, lots of water. My Canadian friends want to make sure I say the Canadian side is prettier. So
it's probably so true.
Probably true. But what most people don't do is go back up river about 2 or 3 miles. It's calm. It's peaceful. You can get in and out of the water. You can make choices about what you want to do. As you get closer to the falls, when we've been there, it was, you know, you have a roaring sound of the water. There's like a sign on the side saying, hey, you in the barrel, get out, that kind of thing, right? And then you get close, there's even a cable trying to save people.
Well, the pace picks up.
Yeah, there's a point of no return. And this was what happened with the inmates I worked with, where 2 days before in the lunch line, when someone elbowed them, they could make a different choice. When they're down on the rec yard with a shank trying to stab somebody, it's too late to make a different choice. They've already made their call.
They're over the falls.
They're over the falls. And so with couples, I ask them to make 4 lists. I ask the husband to make a list about how he knows when he's okay and when he's not okay. I ask the wife to make a list about how she knows when he's okay or not okay. Because sometimes our wife or our husband knows a lot more about how okay we are than we do, right? And then I ask the wife to make a list about the husband and about herself. These 4 lists give you all sorts of ideas of how you know things aren't okay, and I ask them to rank order them. What they do then is they use these lists. And I have some couples that have had a huge picture laminated of Niagara Falls up in their kitchen wall. And they just identify, what are our warning signs? When are we getting close to the falls? When are we getting anxious or upset or angry or frustrated? And they choose to make choices way upriver before they go over the falls.
Yeah, those are in essence the cable, the safety cables.
That's right.
No, that's really right. Good. Mm-hmm. But Ron, you say there's something called unspoken truths and that they can be a silent killer in marriage. What do you mean by that?
This is all the things that you know about your wife right now that you believe to be true, and you're fairly certain that you really can't talk you out of it. You believe, for instance, something like, you kind of are a lazy person. Or someone else thinks, my husband cares more about work than me. Or maybe, you really probably are going to think of yourself before me most times. It's the unspoken truths that are what in scientific world would be called givens. They drive everything else. Because their assumptions that are so powerful, they form the basis of what you choose. one of Jan's assumptions was that she wasn't worthwhile enough to stand up for herself and be treated the way she deserved to be treated. And so she kind of took my inappropriate, ridiculous, immature behavior for many years. We call it learned helplessness. You guys ever remember the old
sure.
animal experience?
Yeah.
They'd shock the dogs. Dogs would jump. Dogs come back down. Eventually, the dogs lay down, and they say, you can shock me, but you can't make me jump.
Right. Undone jumping.
Yeah. And that's, I think that was kind of what it was like for you. It's like, why bother trying? He's not going to listen.
Yeah. And sometimes, especially when I would bring something that was not like money or something, and he could kind of explode out of that, why did you spend that, or those kind of things. And those became my unspoken truth. So I'm not going to talk to him about money because it usually comes back on me.
So you'd hide.
Hide it, yeah.
Emotionally.
Yeah. And then, you know, you buy something, you stick it in your closet in the back and bring it out. And he'd be like, oh, is that new? Well, it's been in my closet for a while. You know, because I knew that if I told him, he might react so negatively. And I already felt bad maybe about buying it. So unspoken truth can really be... strangle your marriage.
Okay, so a woman is going, oh, that's exactly where I'm at today.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do to change that trajectory? How do you work up the courage to say, we need a different way of doing this? We need a budget, whatever it might be. How do you go about doing that?
I think if you can agree as a couple, even if you're not going to make changes immediately, just to say it out loud, there's a way you can do this. You can say something like, my husband always, or I wish my wife wouldn't, and fill in the sentence and show it to each other and say, I don't know how we can work on this, but I want to say it out loud. I want to let God know. I want to let you know this is not okay. And maybe you can even say, how does this work with the kind of man Christ called you to be? Is this consistent? Just throw a little guilt trip in there, you know.
And this is not the kind of thing, Ron, that a couple should just spring on each other, right? I mean, I shouldn't go home tonight and say, hey, I was thinking about things that you shouldn't do anymore, and here's my list.
Yeah, let's not start there.
Right? I mean, the context is very important here.
If they were going to start, I'd start with, here's some things I've learned about myself that I want to do differently.
That's good.
Let's share an example first and then say, and maybe if you have some time, it'd be great if you think of some things that maybe could be better for on your side of the street.
Yeah. Ron, it feels like what you and Jan are talking about is really developing an attitude of graciousness towards your spouse, a heart of graciousness rather than a heart of stone.
And I think you uncover some things that you may not be aware of and how important it is. You can start this by being positive. You know, I love these things about you. You don't always want to start with the negative and then go into what Ron was talking about.
And really, it's a win-win when they both start with that perspective. How do I become more gracious toward my spouse?
Exactly.
Well, that's where the self-focused marriage is all about me, and you can't do that. The other focused marriage, you got to trust your partner, because if I've got your back and you've got my back, we're fine. But what happens if you're a giver and I'm a taker? That doesn't work well.
Yeah.
And so you've got to be fair.
And we're right at the end, but I do want to grab that question for that spouse who's saying, I'm pretty good. I'm in a good spot. I'm all right. But it's my spouse. That guy, he's this, he's that. How does that spouse, and it doesn't have, you know, just put it in a generic term, but how does that person make that turn to not amplify the spouse's negatives and amplify their righteousness?
I can only speak for myself. I had to look directly in the mirror, hear what God was saying, what God's taught me to be, what the Bible tells me to be, and see the discrepancy between what I'm called to be and who I am. And you have to be honest with yourself and God and say, I can't keep living this way because this isn't who you've called me to be.
Yeah, this is good stuff. I mean, you two have really hit it. And it's a great reminder that simple choices can make a huge difference in our marriages. That's what I love about it. It is the simple things. It's not the Hollywood theatrical release and the big music and the wonderful expensive dates or whatever it might be. It's loving each other regularly and every day. And
helping each other,
yeah,
too.
Definitely.
I think we're called to help each other.
And let me turn to the listener. If you're feeling inspired to start transforming your marriage but aren't sure where to start, head over to the website, and John's going to give those details. Take our free marriage assessment. It's wonderful. We've had almost 1 million people do that, and I've taken the assessment myself, and I appreciate both my strengths and probably more my weaknesses, because I can see where I need to improve. And I would really want to encourage you to get this wonderful book, 10 Choices Successful Couples Make.
Get the book and take the marriage assessment, all the details at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast. Or if you prefer to call us, we can tell you more, 800, the letter A in the word family.
You know, also, John, man, we do surveys every year. Hundreds of thousands of couples have been helped through Focus on the Family, the Lord working through the broadcast, the podcast, all of it, YouTube. And I would encourage you to help us. And if you can make a gift of any amount, we'll send you the book by Ron as our way of saying thank you. If you're in a place where you can't afford it, we're going to trust others will take care of that. And we'll send it out to you. If your marriage is in a desperate situation, we want to get this into your hands. So if you can't afford it, that's fine. Get a hold of us. We'll get it to you. And for those that can help support us, that's what we're doing, is ministry together.
Mm-hmm. And we invite you to become part of our monthly sustainer team by making a monthly commitment to support the ministry. We call it our Friends of the Family program. Details again online, or call 800, the letter A in the word family.
Ron and Jan, thank you so much again for your transparency and for your willingness to be here. Love the book, love the content, and love the way you guys interact. It's refreshing. Thank you.
Thank you for
thank
having us.
Thank you so much.
And thank you for joining us today for Focus on the Family with Jim Daly. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back next time as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.